Today I went to an appointment and asked for my medical records and medical history, and it asked me if I had allergies or surgeries or any sort of medical ailments or physical sicknesses or infirmities. I had zero. And I was like, health is the best wealth. I am so grateful that right now I have health. But then, when it came to asking about mental health, anxiety and depression, I had to click yes on both of those. On and off throughout the years, I've struggled with anxiety and depression. But as I left, I started thinking, what if I live as though I don't have anxiety and depression? Like, I actually feel happy right now. So what if I just didn't give anxiety, worry, depression, despair the sort of weight that I usually give it? Like, I was at the beach with my buddy today, and he was finding sea glass on the ocean, and we were throwing the football, and I'm like, okay, what if I lived as though I didn't have anxiety? Like, what if I didn't always catastrophize, do disaster dress rehearsals, and always look for something else to worry about? Like, if I lived as though I don't have an anxiety depression, then suddenly I feel a lot more joyous and buoyant. Like, it's actually a pretty good way to live, as if you have a sound mind and not a sick mind. And I thought about that. Like, that's kind of my twist on Pascal's wager, as I talked about recently. Pascal's wager, in simple terms, is that if you believe, well, the evidence doesn't show whether or not there is a God, right? But according to Pascal. But if you live as though there is a God, you have a lot more to gain and a lot less to lose than if you believe there isn't a God. Then things are inverted the other way around. So for me, I think that with meaning, like if I live life as though there is meaning, even if there isn't meaning, like I live a lot happier and I have a lot more purpose, at least imaginary purpose. But if there isn't meaning, then, if there isn't meaning and I live as though there's meaning, like at least I lived happier with intentionality. But if I live as though there's no meaning and there actually is, then what if I miss out on my intended purpose? And if there just is zero meaning at all and I live as though there's zero meaning at all, I'll be depressed either way. So I think that's kind of my twist, sophisticated twist, or if you can't be sophisticated in twisting, doing your own sort of spiel and genre and variation on Pascal's wager. But that's what I was thinking. Like, what if I live as though I don't have anxiety and depression? Well, maybe I'll be a whole lot happier because I personally do believe we have meaning. I really do. I believe we have a teleology. Like, look at how we're designed. John Trapp, hundreds of years ago, even before Leibniz, he pointed out our incredible design. Like, just look at our hands. You would think that, like, if I was designing hands, I would make them of stone because stone is hardy. It's durable. But if we had hands of stone, they would actually wear out more quickly than if we have hands made of skin, which are more supple, and even though they're softer, they're more durable. Like, it's an ingenious design. I can see design even in my very hands, like the hands in front of my face. Like, the fact that it's more durable to have hands that are soft and supple compared to hands of stone, that they last longer this way and are actually end up being stronger in the long run than hands of stone, it's pretty cool, right? It shows design. It shows that we are intended. And I tend to believe with Leibniz, I don't tend to believe, I absolutely believe with Leibniz that there is something more to the universe than arbitrary atoms. I believe in the superior idea of atoms, that there is something akin to monads. Like, I know that this is an out there theory on one hand that Leibniz had, you know, over 300 years ago, but it is worth kind of dusting off, extracting and extrapolating and extirpating from the deeps and digging up this treasure and this artifact. And see, Leibniz believed, and I'll get into monadology in a little bit, his famous monadology, but he believed that the wise and exalted soul thinks that there is only God in itself in the world. So it's sort of a theological solipsistic perspective, a theological solipsistic POV. Like, if I believe that there's only God and myself in the world, then the vastness of my soul leaves no room for anything external to touch it. And that harkens back to Marcus Aurelius saying, the soul's movement is within itself. Like, nothing can touch my soul if I don't give it permission to. So no one can hurt me. Like, it's not that you're irritating, it's that I'm irritable. Like, and it's been said, an entire sea of water can't sink a ship unless the water gets inside the ship. Similarly, all the negativity of the world can't bring me down unless I let it get inside me. And so if I believe that the solipsistic theological idea, there's only God and myself in the world, and nothing exterior can touch my soul, because as Aurelius said, my soul's movement is in itself, I'm going to be calm and placid. I'm going to have ataraxia, self-sufficiency. I'm not going to move in the world as an anxious presence. Rather, I'm going to be a non-anxious presence in the world, and I'm going to have ataraxia and eudaimonia. So that's kind of a cool way of looking at things. But he talked about, and this is called psychic idealism, but he talked about as somebody who believed in God, he said by all evidence, he said Leibniz wrote that the wise soul, the exalted soul, thinks that there's only itself and God in the world. So this protects us against, this protects us against the exterior things because the soul has its own vastness. The soul alone, together with God, is sufficient for itself. Like, I don't need anything other than me and God because my soul is the world. Wow. Wow. Have you ever heard that before? The very universe is an animate and perpetual expression of the soul. So later on, when you have German ideal, transcendentalism by Emerson, which plays on German idealism, and that is that my perceptions create the world, I am a transparent eyeball. This harkens back to something Leibniz wrote about psychic idealism, which is really, really interesting stuff. So in Leibniz's system, we were talking about monads. He believed this superior system to atoms, that monads make up the world. Monads are immaterial, indivisible, unifying spiritual realities that manifest themselves in the physical world imprinted psychically on our perceptions. Okay, so this is pretty deep stuff that he's coming up with. It's not too dissimilar to ideas and forms in Platonic thinking. Plato believed that everything material we see in the world is just a facsimile or it's a shadow copy of what's happening in the invisible realm. So everything material, every object that we materially see is a projection of something spiritual, invisible, that we cannot see, ideals and forms. So that's something Leibniz is offering. So not only does he believe that if I solipsistically think that there's nothing but myself and God in the world theologically, then the vastness of the soul protects itself against exterior things. It alone, together with God, is sufficient for itself and has autarkia, as he writes about in the monadology. But also, he believes the very universe is an animate and perpetual expression of the soul. So everything I see materially is a projection of what's happening inside of me, that my atoms are actually monads, and they're reflections and echoes of the ultimate monad, as the Pythagoreans taught, which is a unity and an entirety, basically another name for God himself. So in Leibniz's system of metaphysics, monads are basic substances that comprise and make up the universe, but they lack spatial extension. And remember, Leibniz and Newton are both credited with creating inferential calculus independently of one another. And he talks a lot about the idea of movement. And because monads lack extension, they are hence immaterial. So each monad is not only indivisible, but it is unique and it's dynamic. Basically, monads are soul-like entities that have properties that are functions of perceptions, they're soul-like entities whose properties are a function of its perceptions and its appetites. So they're spirit-like little ghost beings, if you would. You could call this psychic idealism. In other words, everything we see in the world is just imprinted on our soul. It's psychic idealism. It doesn't actually exist in physical realities. They're just manifestations of what's happening in the immaterial world. So they're painted on our eyes as if they are consisting of objective reality, when that's an abject failure to realize, according to Leibniz, that we're just seeing a physical world projected from a spiritual hologram, as it were. So monads are the fundamental existing things, like the thing behind the thing, right? That's the ultimate monad. So like I've talked about so many times, Democritus and Locke ended up believing that matter was the thing in itself that exists independently of our objects via our perceptions. And then, of course, Arthur Schopenhauer believed the will to survive, or actually specifically, more specifically, the evil will is the thing in itself, the object in itself, right? That is that noumenon or X is what Kant believed it was. Well, apparently Leibniz seemed to believe it was monads or the ultimate monad. They're spirit realities that lack a spatial extension and hence are immaterial. So they're unique, indestructible, indivisible, dynamic, soul-like entity whose properties are a function of its appetites, appetitive, and its perceptions. So they are the basic substances, the thing in itself or the things in itself that make up the universe. So monads are the fundamental existing things. His theory of monads is meant to, again, be a superior alternative to atoms, even though atoms are nothing more than monads. So he did a little fun twist there. Adams, that was becoming, the theory of Adams was becoming popular in natural philosophy in that day, and he was talking about it was becoming more and more atheistic and materialistic, whereas monads gave a more spiritual, gave a greater spiritual depth to metaphysics and philosophy. So monads have no true causal relation with other monads, even though it might seem like it. Even Hume talked about how there's no such thing incontrovertibly as cause and effect. When you see one billiard ball hitting another, you see one thing following another, it doesn't mean one thing caused the other. So too, even though monads seem to cause each other, they actually are not causal relations that they possess with one another, but all are perfectly synchronized with each other by the ultimate monad, which is God himself, in a pre-established harmony. So the objects of the material world are simply appearances of collections of monads. Pretty compelling stuff. If I live my life as though there is a spirit reality, there's this ancient Jewish story about a prophet named Elisha who was in Dothan and he was being attacked by a bunch of Syrians. They were encompassing him and ensconcing him and laying wait, besieging him all around. And he wasn't scared at all, but his servant Gehazi was terrified. And he's like, you don't need to be scared. God opened his eyes and basically in this story, he sees angels and chariots of fire all around. And he's like, oh, wow. Like, there's a greater army surrounding the Syrians than the Syrians are surrounding us. So I think when you live with monadology, even if it's not that exact idea, but something akin to ideals, forms, monadology, when you believe there's a spirit world and you live your life with meaning, you can live with a sound mind, which is spiritual, that imprints itself upon the physical mind, which is your synapses and your neurons and your 3-pound brain, your cerebral gray matter, and suddenly you're living your life in a spirit way where you don't have so much anxiety, you don't have so much fear, because you're like, you know what? I will into existence a greater ataraxia and calmness and Epicurean peace, not by believing everything is material, but by believing that there is something spiritual projecting it, that there is the ultimate monad, the causeless cause, the prime mover behind the thing, the indivisible reality, then I can live my life with a lot more peace. So what I'm trying to say is live spiritually, not by subscribing to a certain religion. I don't think you need to subscribe to a religion or a church. You just live your life free, knowing that there is a divine order, a logos to things, and you have direct access and connection to the ultimate monad. And when you live your life and say, hey, I'm not gonna be anxious and depressed, I'm gonna live as though I'm not anxious and depressed, you watch how much more peace you have, because there's more going on here. There's more than meets the eye for he who has eyes to see.